So I'm going to start by giving you a kind of brief introduction to some of the overlapping, overlying, underlying general ideas on corruption. And then we're going to have two experts who I'll introduce in a moment. Experts in having looked at it. As they say, as we had in our first presenter, Andrew reminded us that, you know, perhaps there's no better way than having experienced it. But that actually does make for me my first point, which I made in a kind of haphazard way yesterday when we were talking about the pattern thing. The corruption comes in many, many forms, in many varieties, and I'm going to submit to you that it's a fact of life, okay? So we are all engaged in corruption, probably every day, okay? We just label it differently, and it's different levels of toleration. But what we want to discuss today is the serious corruption, the obvious corruption, the corruption that all of us feel, whatever our religious, ethical, cultural backgrounds, we do have a notion of someone being corrupt. If one of you came up to me and paid me to give you an academic certificate, I don't think there's anyone who's going to doubt, whatever cultural background you come from, that that doesn't smell good, okay? There's something wrong with that. So we do know what corruption is, regardless, but I don't think it's somehow primordial. It's not endemic. It's not somehow related to a particular kind. It's not all people over 6 foot who are corrupt. It's not all people who live in hot climates that are corrupt. It's not all people who have six toes that are corrupt. So we have to kind of get down to looking at some of the kind of structures. And we probably think that corruption is where the kind of purer individual values that we feel have separated away from the desired norms that we all, I submit, recognize, okay, even if we're not able to practice it. And where the modes of governance and administration in the territory where we are based have somehow decayed, somehow they're badly structured, for whatever reason, historical, traditional, or they are being inefficiently policed, okay? So we have to look at the structures, and we have to look at the separation between our personal behavior and what we think of as desirable norms. All these are contested ideas, but they give you a framework for understanding what corruption is. We haven't got time to look at all the drivers of corruption. One of the biggest drivers, and Michael, my friend, is very keen on this, is parties. Particularly problematic, I think, in the West at the moment, but in all countries. Parties, there's often no rule or arrangement in a society for the funding of a party. Parties are somehow an extra political being. An individual is represented, an individual gets a salary, an individual may have a ministerial post. But how does a party present itself? How does it do an election campaign? How does it compete for public attention? These are grey areas, and there's been a huge amount of legislation to try to control the size of donations, the number of donations, the transparency of receiving donations, of the way you spend it. But, you know, in America, we could say that they're the geniuses at getting around any kind of legislation. They have the toughest legislation, and yet they have the highest level of breaking of rules without any problem at all. They use offshore arrangements. They set up super PACs, or they have NGOs, which are really fake NGOs. We were talking very interestingly about fake NGOs before. So parties are often a big problem. Survival is a problem. In the country where I come from, you need to be corrupt to survive. You really do. Even if you are rich and ethical and afford to be ethical, you won't get your phone fixed unless you're willing to pay the phone guy an extra 100 rupees. Otherwise, he'll just put you back for 6 months. Can you live for 6 months without your phone working, you know, as a cosmopolitan? Obviously, you get to the more serious levels. I mean, you get to organized crime. Certain countries have it more than others, but we all suffer from organized crime, mafia. And multinationals are pretty smart at being corrupt, I think all know that. So it's disparate, it's widespread, we can't be too judgmental about it. But what we can be clear about is the costs of corruption. Okay, let's all be clear about the costs of corruption. Obviously, it undermines trust and the good society, the society we all want to live in, the society in this room where we've learned to make friends, and wherever we've come from, whatever city we've traveled from, I sense, and I'm sure you'll agree, you know, that we've built up a level of trust, both because we know how to behave in a kind of seminar way and exchange ideas, but over meals, over going out together. So that trust is a high value. We don't often financially calculate what it is, but high trust societies work effectively and efficiently. Which is the happiest nation, not easy to measure, in the world? Often Denmark. Where is the highest trust value? Denmark. Okay, there are lots of tables now about which is the country that pays the highest bribe, which is the country that is the most corrupt. And the countries that come out top, best, if you like, are the Scandinavians. And the ones that often come out worst are some of the African ones and some of the Asian ones. And I guess China is somewhere in the middle, though you might say that in certain places there's extreme corruption. Obviously, it's been tackled. And there's also a kind of general endemic corruption. But it's probably in the middle of the table, so it's getting up about the 80 or 100 mark, if you think there's about 160, 180 countries in the league table. But the top countries appear to be, and I don't want to make judgmental about it, I mean Switzerland, Denmark, Sweden, Norway, they're the top countries. Britain, I think, is 10th or 15th. America is about 25th. I haven't put slides up. We're a slide-free zone, because we want to do this, okay? All three of us, we've made a pact, a super pact, that we didn't exchange any money. So trust is a commodity that we value. Corruption breeds inequity, okay? Inequity is also a cost in society. Often the happiness quotients find out, and it's a bizarre thing, but you're all familiar with this research now. I mean, 10, 15 years ago, it wasn't very well known, that we're more unhappy if we know that our neighbor, our colleague, the person sitting next to us in a plane or whatever, earns twice as much as us than we are the fact that we are poor, okay? So happiness seems to be contingent on what we think other people are getting or deserving, in more contrast to us, okay? So the plane example is very good, because if you ask people in a plane what they paid for their ticket, it can range between, you know, 60 euros super deal, booked 3 months in advance, to the guy who booked it last minute and paid 300. And it kind of creates a degree of unhappiness. We've all been there, haven't we? Nothing worse than coming, I mean, I don't know if people shop, but imagine you come back, I'm sure you don't shop for posh handbags, but imagine you come back with a wonderful handbag and say, I paid 250, your friend says, well, I got it for 50, you know, that makes you unhappy. So inequity, though, in a deeper sense, of course, because corruption allows richer people to get richer and makes poorer people get poorer. And inequity is a huge cost. And the sense of undermining of values. Nobody likes to imagine that they're part of a society with low values, low ethics. I submit that that's a good in itself. So I want to be frank, but we're going to have some presentations. I don't think there's no quick fix solution to deal with corruption. And I thought the paper where you have to kind of educate for ethics is a long-term goal. And each situation is different, and it needs constant self-examination. But we can try to look at a certain kind of approaches. And the theoretical, so I'm just setting some theoretical frameworks for you, the theoretical process of trying to deal with it is obvious, okay? Number one, reduce the incentive to be corrupt. Okay. Secondly, increase the cost of being corrupt. Reducing the incentive, of course, is by punishing, by huge sanctions, by exposing. The Chinese are very good at this. If they do catch somebody, they make them a public victim. Okay. In the West, we tend not to do that enough, I think. But also, my own personal strategy is to reward those who might have been corrupt and are not. Okay. So I think that you have both a stick and a carrot kind of approach. But let's be clear then what we mean by corruption. Okay. And I want to submit this definition. So I think corruption occurs when person A, who is in a position of office in government or politics, i.e. in a position of some trust, breaks or rule or norm B, and thereby provides gain or profit to a third party or to him or herself, C. Okay? So those are the three elements. It's a pretty obvious definition, but let's be clear about what we're talking about. And it's how do we deal with it? Well, we're going to have some ideas and discussions now. But the key thing, I think, is a degree of judicial independence. If we can take cases to an arbitration system in which we trust. If we don't trust the system, and there's low trust, and we don't trust each other, and we can't trust our publicly trusted officials, we're really in a quandary, in a circle. And in some societies, and I'd say Russia is an example of that, it's really serious. But the simplest way to deal with it is disclosure and transparency. Okay. So we were talking, I think you were talking about, who was talking about tendering? Yeah, tendering, okay? So Chile had a huge corruption problem, and then it was persuaded to put all its public tenders on the internet, okay? Putting public tenders on the internet is only step one. You then put on the criteria, you then put on the internet all those who applied, you then put on who got it, and then you explain why. Public disclosure. So all those who were excluded have some notion of, I mean, it still may not be perfect, it's never going to be perfect, but you have some way of seeing the problem. And it's free. The wonderful thing about the internet, although it causes, you know, all kinds of distortions and so on, but we have a free way of sharing information. So when a politician's elected, you simply ask him or her, disclose their assets, you disclose the funding and support that they get, and then they, in a sense, are entrapped by themselves. Okay, and I think that is the way to go forward. But there are all kinds of other things. In independent media is very powerful, a devolution of power, so it's not all controlled in the center, a meritocratic public sector system based on exams and transparent appointments, reform of political parties that I was talking about, an ombudsperson that you can appeal to, and that can be in all kinds of sectors and so on. I mean, in Europe it's very well developed, of course. Ethics programs and hyper-regulation of the private sector, this is what Xiwei was talking a bit about. E-governance strategies, which I just mentioned about tendering. Use e-governance. Use it in a positive way. But people also have to know which sites to go to and so on. But you can do that through NGOs can educate, schools can educate. Obviously, training and education, we've talked about that, but that's going to be long term. And presenting knowledge and data in accessible ways, and actually spending money on public information campaigns. Okay, so there are ways of dealing with this, and the ways of building coalitions to tackle corruption. So, you know, there are these, I haven't done the slides, so I'm saying there are all these kind of tables on who pays the most bribes, which countries are perceived to be the most corrupt, and they do that by talking to people who transact, i.e. they contact businessmen, diplomats, and so on. And I actually worked with Transparency International. It's very interesting, the World Bank actually didn't think corruption was an issue, okay, because its main job was to encourage trade and business. And they were told by the CEOs that trade and business often required corruption, otherwise how could you make new investments in even developing or poor countries? And suddenly they saw the light in 95, and they see that as a cost. So we have lots of public good corruption statements. The World Bank views good governance and anti-corruption as important to its poverty alleviation mission. So it's seen as a kind of central thing. There's a convention at the International Criminal Court, there's a UN convention on corruption from 2003, there's an OECD corruption convention on combating bribery from 97. The International Monetary Fund, corruption undermines the public trust in government. It also threatens market integrity, distorts competition, endangers economic development, and so on. So there's lots of public arrangements. Funnily enough, the two countries that are least involved in this are America and to some extent China. But there are lots of public statements and commitments to it, and many countries have signed up to it. But of course, there is a problem of enforcement. Okay, so I hope that's helped set the scene a little bit. I'm now going to pass the baton on to my good friend Jonathan. Jonathan and I got to know each other very well over the past 5 years. We're often involved in overlapping projects. Jonathan's background is 30 plus years in Brussels as a very senior bureaucrat, and he's involved in many kind of aspects of European government and has been sent on many, many missions. And one of the places that he's been especially involved in is Romania. And I think you're going to talk a little bit about your experience there and corruption generally. And listen, nobody can hold their hand up and say we're good, okay? The European Commission under Santer had to resign because they, I don't remember the details, but the levels of corruption were quite heavy.
They weren't that heavy, but they were quite egregious, I would say. Yeah, thank you very much, Paul. I mean, I'm speaking not as an academic, but as a practitioner, though I hasten to add, in promotion of rule of law rather than in corruption as such. And I spent 38 years in the Commission, five of them as head of the EU delegation in Bucharest from late 2001 to late 2006 in the run-up to Romania's accession to the European Union. And I want to try to draw a few lessons from my experience there. And I will focus on corruption involving money. That may seem almost a given, but actually there are other aspects of sort of institutionalized corruption where essentially it goes right back to the medieval guilds in this country and throughout Europe, where you protect your brothers. They were usually brothers in those days. And nowadays in the medical profession, if you cut the wrong bit off, the chances are that your colleagues will not blow the whistle to the person whose wrong bit you cut off. And that is still a real problem. It is a form of corruption because it certainly involves a loss to the third party. It is not driven by money. I will focus on money. Second thing is that in terms of the costs of corruption, I would just draw your attention to a report by the working paper put out by the European Central Bank this week, on entitled "Is Corruption Efficiency Enhancing?" It's quite an interesting one. It looks at the idea that in certain situations, corruption can lead to a better outcome than if not the case. And it's an econometric study rather than a political science point of view. And it does, but it does show that in terms of total factor productivity, it looks at resource allocation across 9 Central and Eastern European countries, and it concludes that in small countries, in countries with low political stability and civil liberties, and with weak quality and effectiveness of regulation, increases in corruption are associated with rising misallocation of both capital and labour across firms. Corruption thereby reduces factor productivity growth, and thus doesn't enhance efficiency. So, leave aside any moral considerations, corruption is bad for the country. Now, turning to Romania, Romania has a reputation as being one of the most corrupt countries in the European Union and or in Europe. I wouldn't go so far as to say that that is definitely true, but corruption was and remains, I think, endemic, and it ran from the highest levels of central government to the lowest local official. A euphemistic term in Romanian for a small bribe, mica atenția, a small attention. Little attention. And that term goes, you can find that in Romanian literature in the first half of the 19th century, and it certainly goes back in the second half of the 19th century. So corruption is not a post-communist phenomenon, as some people, or even a communist phenomenon, as some people have averred. And indeed, some people would say that it goes back to the time when Romania was occupied by the Ottoman Empire, and it was, you know, it was the right thing to get round officialdom because they were trying to do down the country and they were foreign occupiers. So not paying your taxes was a patriotic duty. Unhappiness and inequity, I think, just to confirm what Paul has said, there are a lot of people who look back to Romania under communism when life was pretty grim, but everybody, or the perception was that everybody except the nomenclatura did, they survived, they had a life, they had a job of sorts. They didn't have much, but they all had roughly the same. That is no longer the case. Now, in Romania, some of my experience, typical cases of low-level corruption, although, you know, they're minor, they're pretty widespread. Bribery of police officers, local government officials, doctors, in many instances, in order to get what you're entitled to anyway. Medical treatment in Romania is free. But if you went into hospital for a major operation, the family is expected to rally around with hard cash. In the early 2000s, it was dollars. And in 2004, the going rate was $50 a day to the nurses. And make sure you give it to the right nurse, because otherwise they won't be happy. You know, it has to go to the person in charge. $500 to the surgeon and $100 to the anaesthetist. And this was a free service. Equally, and more positively, I had a Romanian colleague who was totally morally opposed to this culture of bribery, and she took her small daughter to see a pediatrician, and she said to me afterwards, I was in a big dilemma. What would she do if there was, in a sense, an entry fee to get into the consulting room, which was frequently the case, you know? And she said, I disapprove of this, but I wasn't going to put my daughter in peril and her health in peril by not paying the bribe. That's the sort of personal ethical moral dilemma. She said, fortunately, this was a doctor who didn't ask for anything. A very good doctor. But you know, that's the sort of low-level personal problem which you get at the level of bribery. Should you have corruption, petty corruption, you know, should you pay for what you're entitled to? And what are the consequences if you don't? High-level corruption, much more substantial, typically mostly linked to public procurement. Plenty of points at which an established procedure can be bent, despite all of the transparency which Paul has talked about. You know, they were obliged to go through, everything was published on the internet, post stuff as well. But You can bend the procedure. You do it at the level of drafting the specification. You do it during the process of evaluation of bids. Unless it's the simple supply of products, even if you can, you know, you have to assess the value of different things, or by not providing what is supposed to be provided. IT equipment provision, which is a major part of EU funding in the run-up to accession, we saw attempts to skew specifications to suit a particular supplier, as well as obviously fraudulent evaluations. And we were actually supervising what came out of all of those procedures and refusing to sign them off. And we had endless redoings of the specifications and redoings of the evaluations and so forth. In other areas, and this was a more recent case, for no obvious reason, you had an awful lot of cars which suddenly appeared in the project as absolutely vital to the needs of the project. Unrelated to the needs, they would be included in the proposed specification with the intention, of course, of their finding their way for public officials and or being sold to private users as soon as the project was launched. There were also instances of civil engineering projects being implemented using lower grade materials than those paid for, with consequent need for early repairs, yielding more income to the construction companies. That's not a peculiarly Romanian habit. I came across one of those more recently in Germany, where Deutsche Bahn were having the high speed line from Aachen to Cologne built, and they discovered subsequently that somebody had been paid off to by the contractor to supply lower grade materials. They had a big question as to whether the line was in fact safe in winter conditions. They eventually came to the conclusion it was, so you can safely go on the high speed train from Brussels to Cologne. But it's not just Romania. Local authorities could also make implementation of a project conditional on bribes to deliver the various permits needed for work to go forward. It's not just getting the contract, it's not just the government approving, you've also got a lot of local government involved. So, you know, you don't issue the certificates. And I can recall one case where, with the agreement of the constructor, we publicized such a case. A project had effectively stopped. You had a half-built building. We insisted on the repayment to the EU of the funding we had given. And the county council chairman and the local mayor got extremely, we had a sort of public slanging match in front of television cameras. But happily, I can report that a few months ago, the guy went to jail, only 10 years after the event. I'm not sure it was that particular case, but he's in jail, which I'm very pleased about. And of course, public officials can also use public funding of past projects to generate later benefits, even if the project itself had been entirely above board. The threat of denunciation for fraud and sending in the inspectors for something which had already been completed, which was perfectly good, but you can use the inspectors to inconvenience. And you can get small benefits, dinners, bribes, and so forth. So, that's the sort of thing. And I can't talk about Romania and corruption without mentioning corruption in the childcare sector. The phenomenon of Romanian orphans, many of whom were not orphans, but who were in care, being put up for international adoption in what developed, thanks to the perversities in the legal framework, into a form of child trafficking, and effectively in the late 1990s, until a moratorium was put on it, for $10,000 you could effectively buy a nice Romanian kit. That's not, again, a purely Romanian phenomenon. I suspect that some of that may go on in China as well, but certainly in the past. Apart from this, much of what I've described is not specific to Romania. And Paul's talk said that it's a global phenomenon. It's present in some degree in every country. And I think the difference in degree, in my view, is dependent on a range of factors. The nature of links between politics, business, and media interests. You know, how far can legislation or public policy decisions be tailored to particular interests rather than the wider public benefit? And that is a problem which goes well beyond the Romanian case. I think in almost every country you have some elements of that. At what point does business lobbying move across the line from being legitimate to being illegitimate? Secondly, how the political class sees its role. Are people there to accrue personal or group benefits, or to work for the wider benefit of society, the country as a whole, whatever you you like? My former colleague Michael Guest, who was left as US ambassador in 2004, said on his departing speech, "I look forward to the day when, in Romania as in the United States, people leave politics to make money." Whether he's correct in characterizing the United States, certainly in Romania people went into politics to make money. Second issue, I think, is whether the presiding philosophy of the political class is majoritarian, in other words, trying to gain benefits for the majority, even if not for you in person, but the majority which you represent, or a liberal acceptance of the need to protect minority interests, which is more in turn with liberal democracy generally. Third factor, how the legislation is formulated, especially the level of discretion that the rules allow for decision by individual public officials. How that legislation is implemented, is there room for people to jump the queue, and or are the barriers to entry or barriers to entry into the decision-making process? Can that be obtained by a little attention to the officials involved? Can e-government help on this? It certainly ought to be able to if it's properly set up. The income levels of those in the decision-making position compared with the potential level of benefits they can obtain from bribes. I'll give you an example which goes back to the mid-1990s, where customs officers in virtually every country in the world receive a commission when they find contraband, and they get a commission on the fines and duties which are levied on that contraband. Now, if you are a reasonably paid customs official, then you know you can live moderately comfortably on your salary, then the commission is a bit of a bonus. But it doesn't make the difference between, it's the jam on your bread. If, however, your salary is extremely low and your commission becomes the main source of income, then you have a lot of incentives to create problems for people crossing through your border post. And, of course, if those people are prepared to make it worth your while, then you collect your commission, in inverted commas, through some other method. And this was very much the case which you found across a lot of Central European border posts during the 1990s. That's all gone, of course, because of the EU accession. Popular culture in relation to corruption. Is it seen as just part of life, a fact of life, as Paul described it, or something reprehensible that should be exposed and punished? And if you just see it as part of life, then you go along with it. And you know, petty corruption in itself may be a part of life and almost inevitable, but on the other hand, if petty corruption, why not grand corruption? You know, at what point does it become unacceptable? Finally, the likelihood of punishment. How does local government, how does government or local administrations deal with allegations of corruption? Will whistleblowing lead to prosecution or prosecution of the whistleblower? Does the judicial system actually support prosecutions? Are the political or social consequences for those who are found guilty? All of those factors, it's not a simple proposition, as Paul has pointed out. All of them need to be addressed. And you know, dealing with one or two or three of those factors without addressing all of them just doesn't work, and we've seen that. Nonetheless, the ECB study does also show that in general over the period 2002 to 2013, corruption declined in all of the nine countries they studied, with the exception of Hungary. I have no idea why. even if not at the same pace.
Kind of at a low base.
No, funnily enough, not. And that may be why. It suggests governments in Hungary may be moving the other way. I've got some triangle charts for sure. 2 minutes, yeah. Okay. What's been done? Romania has made some progress. What's happened? It demanded an awful lot of different things. It included some quite substantial changes in government. Particularly, you had a tendency to pay lip service to all of the pressures from outside, from the US, from the EU, to improve the situation. You had proposals for judicial reform, which were intended partly to address issues of rule of law, which basically took the worst elements of every bit of European legislation they could find and combined them together so as to make them even worse. Some changes in government, and quite a lot of pressure, and interestingly, Romania is still being monitored by the European Union 10 years after accession, maybe 10 years after accession, in terms of its how it is addressing corruption and rule of law issues. But we should never see things as irreversible. Romania joined the EU on the 1st of January 2007, and in March of that year, the Justice Minister, who had worked so hard for the previous two and a bit years in changing the system and improving things, was sacked. That said, we have seen now one former Prime Minister, I think two now, in jail, another one who was indicted for corruption, admittedly while he was not in office, but while he was a serving Prime Minister, he was indicted for corruption. He also had accusations of plagiarising his PhD, and resigned due to public protest over a tragic nightclub fire, where the building licence had been given due to the safety authorization had been effectively corruptly obtained. Over 100 people died. And there was such public protest that Romania now has a technocratic government. We will see what happens. But you still have problems. You still have the parliament, which will not lift parliamentary immunity to allow cases to proceed. You have quite a lot of positive developments, but they're a very long way from getting there. It's often difficult to believe progress can be considered irreversible. Institutional reforms and legislative and regulatory reforms only nibble at the edges. Consolidated success requires strong civil society and public opinion, which is much more vociferous than it was, to be complemented by the development of a political class that respects the ethos of leaving politics to earn money. External monitoring alone won't work. It needs to be driven by internal monitoring with effective teeth. And it's not there yet.
Right. Thank you very much. Okay, so moving swiftly on to our third contributor. Ewan Smith is now at Oxford at Trinity College, but much more important for us, he has taught at a number of Chinese universities, including, I see, Renmin and Beijing and Tsinghua, and he also worked for the Foreign Commonwealth Office and was posted to Beijing for 5 years. So in many ways, his many hats are ideal, with having worked in the civil service and monitoring it, but also as an academic, and I guess a legal background.
Yes.
Over to you, Joe.
Thank you, Paul. I'm going to try and build on what both Paul and Jonathan have said, and I think that there should be some degree of overlap between our presentations, but there's a lot to say about this subject,
yes.
And I think we have to be quite tight in terms of what we focus on. So I absolutely agree with what Paul says, that corruption is a much more subtle and many-faced phenomenon than the kind of definition that we're focusing on here. I think for convenience, we're talking about a phenomenon that involves largely asking officials to do things for you for money. You know, there is a wider discussion to be had about misconduct and a wider discussion to be had about fraud and theft. But just for convenience, that's the phenomenon I'm going to talk about in my presentation. But equally, I'm going to try and look at three of the five exam questions that have been set for this morning's session. I'm going to start by talking about the patterns and extent of corruption in China. I'm then going to talk about whether corruption, or anti-corruption rather, is best focused on individuals or institutions. And then third, I'm going to look at the extent to which law and regulation can diminish corruption in China. But I'd like to start by reading an extract from a novel, which gives a flavour for one way in which corruption takes place in China, which I think has three important implications. The novel's called Qinsu, which means celadon in English, a sort of type of porcelain. And it's written by a man called Hu Gang, who was convicted for corruption in China. He writes under a pseudonym of Fu Shi. And Hu Gang's job was to bribe judges to give his company auction contracts. And through the character in Qinsu, he describes the way that he would go about bribing judges. So it starts with one day, Mr. Zhang decided to deliver to the judge a full case of health-preserving liquor featuring mysterious aphrodisiac formula presented in fine porcelain. The liquor case was heavy, and Judge Ho's apartment was on the seventh floor of a residential complex without a lift. When Zhang finally showed up at Judge Ho's doorstep, panting and puffing, the judge was a little surprised and immediately invited Zhang in. During the visit, Zhang did not mention a word about the court commission. On the same visit, Zhang noticed that Ho was quite concerned about his son's calligraphic performance. After the visit, Zhang managed to persuade a famous calligrapher to agree to see the son. Soon, a tutorship was arranged. After having made this arrangement, Zhang was treated almost like a family member by Judge Ho's wife. He could now pay casual visits to the judge's home without an appointment. During one such visit, Zhang asked for two pieces of calligraphic exercises by Judge Ho's son, which he put up to an artwork auction held by a company run by his former colleague. He then asked a friend to bid for the calligraphy as he instructed a fourth party. A few days later, Zhang visited Judge Ho again and brought an envelope. Zhang explained it was some money Xiaoping, Judge Ho's son, had earned. There wasn't then a discussion about what Zhang wanted from Judge Ho. That came months later and was completely implicit. It was based on a bid for that auctioning contract to the judge's court. I think this tells us something about corruption in China. The most important thing it tells us is this is not a brown envelope. This isn't a straightforward transaction between two individuals, one giving the other money and the other accepting it and then changing his position officially. It's much, much more subtle than that. It involves social connections, it involves traditional cultural and social structures. But it tells us at least two things. Firstly, it tells us that China takes corruption really seriously. If China didn't take corruption seriously, then Zhang wouldn't have to go to these extraordinary Byzantine lengths to bribe Judge Ho. But at the same time, it says that the incentives for corruption are high enough, and the system is not efficient enough to stop this kind of practice taking place. So against that background, I want to look at what the patterns and extent of corruption are in China. So I'm going to talk about three issues under this heading. I'll start by saying what we mean by corruption in China. Second, I'll look at how we could measure corruption in China and the difficulties of that. And third, I'm going to look at some of the causes of corruption in China. So what do we mean by corruption? Aside from the issues of misconduct and theft and fraud, which are common in all countries and are dealt with by different aspects of Chinese criminal codes, corruption can mean several different things. It can mean profligacy, by which I mean using government resources in an inefficient and selfish way. So if you have an official car which you use for private means, if whenever you eat out on the government, you eat out lavishly with your friends, it's a sort of corruption, but it's a different sort of corruption to the kind that I think we're looking at in the main here. It can also mean arbitrary government. It can mean using government power in a way that doesn't have any sort of supervision. And that's a very widespread problem in China, as it is in many countries, but that's not specifically what I want to talk about. It can also mean nepotism. It can mean oligarchy. But I'm going to start with a similar definition to one that Paul gave at the beginning, which is from the UN Convention Against Corruption, Article 15. The phenomenon I'm talking about is the promise, offering, or giving to a public official, directly or indirectly, of an undue advantage for the official in order that the official act or refrain from acting in the exercise of his or her official duties. So the solicitation or acceptance by a public official directly or indirectly of an undue advantage in order that the official act should act or refrain from acting in the exercise of their official duties. It's about bribery, it's about advantages, it's about embezzlement, it's about graft. Now, how does that, China's a signatory of UNCAP, how does that play out in the Chinese criminal code? Well, started in 1997, the Chinese criminal law as amended distinguishes between two different sorts of corruption. One is economic, the other is non-economic, and we'll come on to that distinction later. Economic corruption under the criminal law includes embezzlement, includes bribery, misappropriation, dispersion of state property, illegal gains, tax evasion, speculation and profiteering. But there's a much broader definition, and this fits into the way that the anti-corruption institutions work in China, of non-economic corruption. That includes abuse of power, it includes neglect of duty, it includes nepotism, it includes things like bigamy, it includes illegitimate feasting, it includes feudal rights, it includes illegal imprisonment, and it includes torture. So actually what the Chinese would define as corruption embraces a far broader range of illegal behavior than the UNCAP definition I've just given you. Recently, China created a new article in that criminal code, Article 164, which, as amended, says, whoever, for the purpose of seeking illegitimate commercial benefit, gives property to any foreign public official or official of an international public organization, shall be punished in accordance with the provisions of Article 164. That's not been enforced. So, one issue we're going to come on to is enforcement and how this affects corruption in China. But China has a reasonably thick definition of corruption, both internal and to do with the way that Chinese companies do their business in foreign countries, not all of which is enforced rigorously. So that is the legal definition of what I'm talking about. But how bad is it? This is the second issue under this first heading. Well, how do we measure it? Now, I want to draw upon the TI Corruption Perceptions Index, which Paul mentioned. China's 83rd in the TI Perceptions Index. It's slightly below the middle of the table. That means it's comparable with countries like Brazil, India, the Philippines, Indonesia. It does rather better than Russia, Nigeria, or Argentina. But while all countries have a problem with corruption and misconduct, I don't think it's fair to say that the problem is comparable in China to Europe. So other than Canada and New Zealand, every top 10 country in the TI CPI index is in Europe. Most corrupt countries in Europe would be Bulgaria and Italy, who are 68 and 61st, respectively. China is, I think, significantly worse than those countries. And although it's 83rd this year, last year it was in 100th place on the index. And it fell about 20 places in the course of a year. So I don't think there's a comparable situation. But there's a problem with measuring corruption generally, which is that we measure it by expert evidence or by popular perception. And I'm not going to go into the detailed methodology by which TI conduct their investigation, but it's based on what people think about corruption in their own countries. And those of you who know a little about Chinese politics will know the difficulty of opinion poll surveys, for example, of Chinese citizens on what they think about corruption. And the ways, you know, TI is obviously aware of this, they adapt the methodology to take account of that, but it's difficult to compare pairwise what Russians think about corruption, for example, and what Chinese people think about corruption. So there are weaknesses in this methodology. There are other ways of looking at corruption. Again, they might not tell us absolute things about which country is better or which country is worse, but they can tell us how bad things are, generally speaking, and which direction they're going in. One would be the number of people investigated or prosecuted. Huge numbers of Chinese officials are investigated and prosecuted for corruption, and those numbers have risen sharply since 2012. So I'll start by talking about Britain to give you a sort of baseline by which to compare this. Britain has two statutes that deal directly with corruption, the 1906 Prevention of Corruption Act and the 1896 Public Bodies Corrupt Practices Act, and roughly 50 people have been prosecuted under those two acts between 2003 and 2016. We have a separate tort called Misconduct in Public Office, and roughly similar levels of prosecutions have taken place under that tort. That includes, for example, our phone hacking scandal, our MP's expenses scandal would use that tort in order to bring a prosecution. And many, many more people are prosecuted for fraud, which doesn't distinguish between officials being corrupt and individuals in private organisations stealing money. But again, you know, you're looking at maybe a few hundred prosecutions for fraud, for corrupt practice. Now, in contrast, in 2012, about 33,000 Chinese officials were prosecuted for corruption. So even if you divide down by 20 in order to make China the same size as the United Kingdom, they're still prosecuting many, many more officials than we are. And that's gone up. So that's 2012, before Xi Jinping came to power. Since then, 414,000 officials have been disciplined for party violations. A further 201,600 have been prosecuted for corruption, and about 140 full or half ministers. So about 3,500 ministers in China. So that's not as big as it might seem within another political system. But 140 out of 3,500 top officials in China is still a lot. I don't think we should take this as evidence that corruption in China is rising. It's difficult to use this to map a trend. The reason for that is the top two countries, the highest per capita rate of imprisonment due to corruption, are the United States and Russia. They are 16th and 118th, respectively, in the Transparency International CPI index. So I don't think that tells us kind of where corruption is exactly, but it does tell us that China is taking corruption ever more seriously. Does this tell us that corruption is getting better or worse in China, though? I'm not sure, and I'll come on to that in much more detail when I look at law and regulation as the third heading I talk about. But I think corruption in China is very widespread. My own view is it's very particularly widespread in the Chinese government, and it gets more widespread the more senior in the Chinese government you go. And I will talk about it anecdotally and with reference to press reports, but if you ask a Chinese friend how they got their children into middle school, for example, if you ask a Chinese friend who's ever had to go to a public hospital, if you speak to Chinese officials just below Chuozhang or director level within the administration, how they see corruption within their own organization, you get a remarkably consistent picture. The point I'm going to try and stress now is that goes absolutely to the top of the system and very widely as well. And I'll do that with reference to some of the simpler investigations into senior Chinese officials. So just before Xi Jinping came to power, there were two quite high-profile investigations of Mr. Xi himself and of Wen Jiabao, the then Prime Minister and then Premier, by David Barbosa at the New York Times and by Chris Vasai for Bloomberg. These were very partial accounts of family wealth held by individuals close to the centre. Their methodology was quite straightforward. They generally looked at Hong Kong corporate records. So public companies in Hong Kong have to state their shareholders. If you go through those lists, you can work out who owns bits of those companies and who they're related to. Based on this partial account, I think Chris Vasai found $376 million worth of company assets held by Xi Jinping's family, largely through two brother-in-laws, Deng Jiahui, who's his brother-in-law on his sister's side, and Wu Long, who's his brother-in-law on the other side. They found an 18% indirect stake in a rare earth company with about $2 billion in assets. They found a further public traded technology company with a $20.2 million holding by the Xi family. In contrast, and again I stress this is a limited slice of family assets based on a limited methodology, David Barbosa found family assets held largely by Wen Jiabao's mother worth $2.7 billion. I'll add a few statistics to that. The richest 70 members of the National People's Congress, which is China's legislature, gained more wealth in 2011 than the combined net worth of the United States president, his cabinet, all of the members of the United States Congress, and all of the justices of the Supreme Court. That's how much money they gained in 2011. It's not a total net worth figure. That was leaked by the People's Bank of China, deliberately or accidentally, in 2012. It's an internal Chinese report. If we continue going up the scale, Zhou Yongtan, who was the former member of the Politburo Standing Committee, who was purged in 2012, then arraigned for corruption. According to official figures, Chinese authorities have seized 90 billion yuan from Mr. Zhou. That's about $14.5 billion. It makes him slightly richer than Rupert Murdoch, although necessarily doesn't appear on the world's richest man list. He's about 50th, if you wanted to put him in. So that's the top. And then, you know, there are other cases. Wang Tianlin, China's richest man, was profiled at Bloomberg just before Bloomberg pulled their news reporting service in China. So that report hasn't come out. but we know that his wealth through his company Dalian and Wanda, which owns, for example, Sunseeker Yachts in the United Kingdom, was built through corrupt contacts with government officials. But what I want to do, just to put this in context, is bring it down a level. So if we look at a sort of average Chinese official, you know, so not one of the top 10, there was a case last year, a man called Wei Pengyuan, who was deputy director, so Fu Jiujiang, kind of in the roughly in the middle of the Chinese bureaucracy that plans the economy, the National Development Reform Commission. Mr. Wei was responsible for coal policy under other people who were also responsible for coal policy. The Central Discipline Inspection Commission found 200 million yuan in his house in cash. It's about $35 million in cash. And bear in mind that the highest denomination banknote in China is about 10 pounds. That cash weighed 3.5 tons. They broke 4 cash counting machines in order to establish how much of it there was. That man is the middle level of the Chinese bureaucracy. I'm just going to give one last illustration. Again, I know I'm not trying to reduce this to a statistic or to a figure. I can't do that meaningfully for you. I think this gives you some idea of the problem. The last figure I want to give you is the share price of something called Maltai. Maltai is a type of liquor. It's very commonly used as a gift in China.
I hope lots of people bought their Maltai. We're counting on it.
Maltai's share price, so Maltai is used as a gift. It's often used as a bribe at the very lowest levels. We've kind of clicked down through the different gears within the Chinese system. So if you wish to bribe your sort of local doctor level official, as Jonathan put it, you might do that with a couple of bottles of Maltai. The Chinese expression for "I need to investigate that," or yanjiao, is the same as "I need cigarettes and alcohol." You know, rather, there's a homophone for that. Maotai's share price was 18 Chinese yuan per share in 2006, 4 years after China joined the World Trade Organization formally. By 2008, it had risen to 180 Chinese yuan as the Chinese economy grew proportionately. After the global financial crisis, it fell back to about 85 Chinese yuan. I think that's probably for largely corporate reasons, not really for reasons of corruption. But the bit I want to focus on is when we look at Xi coming to power. In 2012, the share price of Maltai was 250 Chinese yuan. Over the next 2 years, an anti-corruption campaign focused a government austerity bit, and over that period of 2 years, it fell to 120 Chinese yuan. It fell by half, more than half, between Xi Jinping coming to power and the middle of 2014. With no other obvious economic factor influencing that decline, like the global financial crisis which we just discussed. Today, though, at the time when this austerity campaign is nominally still taking place, it's risen to 317, doubled. So, if you model corruption through gifts, for example, you can see increases, declines, other sorts of trends. And those trends do not suggest that Chinese corruption is any less, certainly, at the bottom level of Maotai gifting. Than it was in 2012 when Xi Jinping came to power. So talk another maybe 15 minutes or so.
Ten.
Okay, keep me right. That's why I say it. Okay, I'll hurry up then. I'm going to talk about the causes. I'll talk about looking at individuals, then I'll talk about law and regulation. Does China face a corruption problem, as many other countries do? One issue which Jonathan's already touched upon in respect to Romania is the vestiges of the planned economy. China, before 1978, had an economy of favors because you couldn't pay money in order to obtain social goods. The way you obtained favors and shared them was through social connections. You see this mapped in other post-Soviet economies, like, for example, the Blatt phenomenon in Russia. China faces similar social rules. The second factor, I think, would be the income gap between the public and the private, which opened up in the 1980s and 1990s. In a culture which has valued public service, I think probably to a greater extent than European countries, noticing that people who jumped in the sea, as they put it, who left public service for private enterprise, were earning many, many multiples of what public officials earned, I think created a sense of resentment and consequence of resentment in the 1990s. And this was aggravated by the structural changes brought about by the dismantling of the planned economy. So, remember the Tiananmen protests were protests about corruption. They came about because China created a dual pricing system in the 1980s where you could buy goods at different prices depending on what you wanted to use them for, and that created scope for arbitrage for Chinese officials. But I think there is a broader structural problem caused by an underdeveloped integrity system in China. Chinese civil service involves close concentrations of power in the first in command, the Yibashou. So if you wish to build a railway project in China, you maybe need 3 approvals, whereas you need 3,000 in Britain or the United States. And that creates conditions for people to seek rents. The ineffective enforcement of regulation also creates rent-seeking opportunities. And because Jonathan's covered that, I think, in quite good detail in respect to Romania, I'm not going to repeat that in respect to China. But perhaps most important, there is a very large measure of arbitrary government in China with very low levels of transparency. That's the main problem. China is about mid-table for corruption in the CPI index, but it's at the very, very bottom of the Reporters Without Borders Press Freedom Index. It does not have a watchdog media. Even internally, particularly over the last 2 years, there has been a sharp decline in the ability of the Chinese media to report corruption stories within its own borders. So I'll come to talk about that at the very end. But next I want to go to the second issue, which is whether the blame for corruption should focus on individuals or on systems. Corruption doesn't happen without individuals, but then again, it doesn't happen without institutions either. And I think institutions are better at rectifying individuals than individuals are at rectifying institutions. And particularly since Xi Jinping has come to power, we've seen a shift in policy in China. Hu Jintao, who I think was a party institutionalist, was keen to implement rule of law in China, for example, didn't succeed entirely, but I think was pushing towards a more institutionalized system of corruption prevention, to what I would call voluntarism, a focus on the deficiencies of individuals. So I'll give you a couple of illustrations. Xi himself says we should govern with virtue and keep order through punishments. That's a reflection of a quote from Confucius. And this plays out in, for example, the decision of the Fourth Party Plenum, which looked at rule of law in 2014, where their aspiration is a system not of rule of law as we would know it, but a system in which no one dares to be corrupt, no one can be corrupt, and no one wants to be corrupt. It's focused on individuals. Andrew Nathan, who's a Chinese political scientist of China, based in New York, considered a similar idea in respect to the constitutional tradition of China. And he concluded that this focus on individuals, on individual error, which is, there's a very deep philosophical background to this. It goes back to Confucius and back to Han Feizi, and other people in the room will be much better placed to quote on that than I will. Andrew Nathan says this leads in a very different direction from constitutionalism, from the rectification of institutions. In fact, it leads to a sort of authoritarianism. And I think this is most obvious in a statement by Chen Jinping, who's the party secretary of the China Law Society. He wrote an article in Qiaoshe, the party propaganda magazine, in 2014 that said, laws cannot just be articles on paper. They must be written into the hearts of citizens, ensuring that rule of law becomes a sort of belief for the whole people. I think if rules and regulations are powerless to enforce good government in the absence of indoctrination or thought reform, I think that sort of indoctrination makes constitutions and institutions superfluous. I think individuals obviously play a role in the anti-corruption focus, but the change in policy towards individual responsibility rather than rectification of institutions, I think, is a step backwards from the sorts of policies that China would need to deal with the problem. So that leads us to our final issue, which is, well, can law and regulation diminish this problem? I think it's obvious that laws alone can't diminish it. And I'll look a little bit at the current anti-corruption campaign and what that means. So this isn't just a matter of passing laws and regulations. Laws are necessary, but they're not sufficient to deal with corruption. Since 1978, more than 1,000 anti-corruption regulations and laws have been passed in China. As of 1998, there were about 249 laws. That was increased to about 542 in 2007. And if you read the state press on this, they see this to be a great achievement. The anti-corruption problem will be solved by legislation. But laws are prosecuted highly selectively in China, and I'll come on to that in a minute. There are, however, other policies that have been remarkably effective in reducing corruption. Jonathan has mentioned two of these. You look at how many people regulate a particular issue, you look at how much they're paid relative to their commission, you look at how they're supervised. Those sorts of bureaucratic reforms will improve a corruption problem in any country. And China has improved that, particularly since Xi Jinping. However, the three policies which China's already considered, asset disclosure, transparent discussion of corruption in the public sphere, and enforcement of existing laws, I don't think have been so successful. So So an asset disclosure, for a start, this was trialled. Asset disclosure is basically where individual officials have to tell people how much they own every year. And that's politically sensitive. So for example, again, asset disclosure is one of the demands of the protesters at Tiananmen. But China trialled this. The Central Discipline and Selection Commission and the party had a trial in a place called Altai Province in Xinjiang. And in Altai, this ran from about 2008 to about 2010. And the top officials in Altai, I think about 1,000 of them, had to declare how much they owed. This was quietly done away with in 2014. Asset disclosure is not happening anymore. And indeed, people who call for asset disclosure, like Xu Jiyong, who was the head of the New Citizens Movement, have been put in prison, in this case for 18 years, partly for calling for asset disclosure. This leads us to the question of transparent discussion in the public sphere. China, as I say, currently does not have a watchdog media, has had seeds of a watchdog media at various times in its history, particularly recently, and especially between about 2009 and about 2013. Social media was an important conduit for stories about corruption, particularly official corruption, to be aired. Since then, China has passed regulations that will place people in detention if rumours they create on the internet are visited by 5,000 internet users or reposted more than 500 times. It's also purged leading bloggers who post on corruption, like Charles Xu and Mansfield. That's now led to an amendment in the Chinese criminal law in 2015, which provides for 7 years in jail for spreading rumours. So, I think under those circumstances, it's much more difficult for China to fight corruption. But this bleeds into some of the discussion we had yesterday about legitimacy. You know, I think this is actually a practical judgment by the party. The party does want to improve corruption, but realises that techniques like full asset disclosure by the top officials and full public discussion of corruption by the Chinese population would lead to a catastrophic fall in the popularity of the party and the party's legitimacy. And based on that agonistic view of legitimation rather than legitimacy that Vivian Xu put forward yesterday, I think there are compromises to be made here. You know, if that is the ultimate aspiration of the party, to have clean government, the way in which that's achieved, the way in which it's staged, and over what kind of period of time that can be done, is, I think, a serious question. And it's not simple, you know, it is not as simple as just changing the rules. The last thing I want to talk about is the current anti-corruption campaign. Is this a step forward or a step backwards? Well, as I've already touched upon, I think it's a voluntarist campaign. I think it's focused on individual responsibility. It's not just a political campaign. It is a political campaign, but it's not only a political campaign. So we have seen more corruption cases prosecuted. However, it falls far, far short of uniform enforcement of existing anti-corruption laws. So how selective is corruption enforcement in China? Well, again, we don't quite know. There is a body of literature from the late 1990s and early 2000s when it was slightly easier to research this, and it suggests that at least at that time, enforcement was highly selective. So in the late 1990s, about 95% of investigated cases of non-cadres, so people who were not officials, were prosecuted. 57% of cadre corruption cases were prosecuted. And the academic literature, both within China and outside of that time, says the same thing that both Paul and Jonathan have said, that non-exposure of corruption was used as a tool by the party hierarchy, and in particular, it was used to incentivize economic growth within certain regions. Equally, the most emblematic corruption cases that have come out of the current crackdown, Zhou Khan, Xu Caiho, the Central Budget Commission, are political opponents of Xi Jinping. So what has this done? This will be the last point I'll come to. Well, the anti-corruption campaign has produced fear and inaction amongst Chinese bureaucrats, but it hasn't necessarily stopped corruption. So in particular, if you are the Chinese official responsible for conducting trade negotiations with private enterprises for the state, you are going to be very cautious about working with particularly foreign companies, but even private entities within China. You have lifelong responsibility for the decisions you make, and if one of them is taken down, you will be taken down with it. I think that has created a shift away from the private sector and towards safe bets, towards state-owned enterprises in particular. This is difficult to document, but, for example, the policy of the Chinese government is to open up the economy to private enterprise. That's what the Chinese government wishes to do. But the phenomenon they describe as bureaucratism, is stopping private enterprise and foreign companies having access to important economic goods because officials are frightened of the consequences of dealing with unsafe companies. So some of the more economic literature describes opportunities are slightly more likely to fall to bigger firms, and they're definitely more likely to fall to state-owned enterprises than to non-state-owned enterprises since the crackdown. So I think that's the last thing I say. I'd like to come on to questions after that. If you want to, we can come to the sixth panel and look at corruption in October this year. That will be the sort of main event in the Chinese political calendar this year. And I'll wrap up there.
Thank you very much, Ewan. That was masterly and very revealing, really. I think revealing to everybody. Perhaps some of our Chinese colleagues know the range and depth of it, but there was a lot in it. And I hope you've enjoyed all the presentations. So now I want to encourage quite a vigorous and lively debate. I'm going to start with our two discussants, Sipka and Robert. Try to make 2 points each, okay? Try to keep it to 2 points each. And then what I'm going to do is to take a lot of other contributions. And then we have to come in towards the end. Would you like to participate to make some notes?
Just
are you okay? All right. So, go.
Okay. thank you very much, first of all. I have prepared actually one kind of answer I wanted, and that was a sort of an answer to how corruption is framed nationally or culturally. And I think all of you three beautifully answered my first sort of orientation. So I firstly want to ask you, Paul, because I really like the definition you gave in the beginning about corruption. But I do think that I would like to add one thing to the beginning, and that's because you start with somebody who's in a position and there's a rule, and somebody who's provided for. But the one who, I think the one who provides in some situation also needs to ask. So there's somebody who can provide, and also somebody who asks that person that can provide to do that. And so in that way you have sort of an extra sort of conversation that needs to be added, I think. And I would like to ask your opinion on that. I wrote my notes in between, I'm sorry.
Should we come back to you? Come have a look. More, Robert, you go next. And then
thank you very much.
Back to you when you find
thank you very much for interesting 2 points of view from...
just so we can hear you.
Okay. Thank you very much for really two interesting views from China and from Europe. And I have a first question, which would be also about China and Europe. So about lobbyists. What's the role of the lobbyist in China? How is this legally system? How it looks like? How is this in Romania? And first of all, how Ms. Scheele see the system which is in place in Brussels? I can just show that the Polish system is not working, like nationally, and how it is in Romania. And the second question will be about, because Dr. Smith mentioned that there is a kind of selection of cases which are indeed prosecuted or are like the real discussion in real discussed in the public. So do you think, in your opinion, this kind of corruption is used in the inside like party play between different factions? You mentioned that it's obvious that this corruption or any kind of corruption was obvious in investment in the West, and now it's kind of argument between factions. When they fight, they get they select which kind of case should be used.
Very good.
Thank you.
Who else would like to come in? I mean, everybody, please show so I get some idea. Or I'll take the. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. Let's take these and then we'll work backwards. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay.
Mr. Scheele, I was wondering, I was very interested, it interested me a lot because also from Paul's talk, there was a lot of talk about very things that you cannot really touch upon. It was inequity, some kind of kindness also in corruption. So there is a lot of, it's a bad thing and a lot of bad long-term effects, but it starts with some kind of equal position that's sort of understood in society. What you also talk about, where there's in Romania a very long history of corruption, where it's more of a cultural thing or a historical thing that it's recognized by everybody. So I was wondering what you think of maybe not only in Romania but also in China, but Dr. Smith also talked about it's a terminology and what effect terminology has on corruption, where there's a sort of mutual understanding that underlays and sort of
that is wrong.
Yes,
and
it's
understand.
Wrong.
Okay.
But it's okay. And then for Smith,
well, two
have
points.
Yes.
You have to hold yours now.
Oh.
Andrew.
Yeah, thank you very much. Really very impressive. The one question I had was, is there, to anyone on the panel, but is there an inherent contradiction in one way of dealing with corruption is to, you know, pass laws and enforce laws and things, but that laws themselves, you know, an excess red tape, this kind of phrase, also calls room for corruption, and that maybe if you have too many laws, then you provide the officials with opportunities to get benefit by bypassing them. That's my basic question.
Interesting.
So I have two questions. The first one is for Mr. Jonathan. I just gave a presentation about the corruption in Chinese charity, and I wonder if there are any measures in Romania or other countries have some measures to prevent the corruption in charity or
some,
NGOs.
Some what?
Measures. And the second one is for...
We'll give that a brief answer, because there are lots, and we'll discuss
okay.
it over lunch.
Okay, okay. Yeah. The second one is for Dr. Smith. And we have a tradition, Chinese people have traditions called Li Sheng Wang Lai. We send gifts to others, and others give return back the other gifts. We have a culture of drinking, culture of cigarettes, and many other cultures. So how do we deal with the conflicts between the within particular tradition and the constitute or the laws?
It's a very important question.
Yeah.
I mean, we have, Koreans, Indians, we all have this gift giving.
Yeah, yeah,
you
yeah.
give a gift, and then 10 years later, you say, "My son needs to come to Oxford." So I'm waiting. Number three.
Yes, my question is also for Dr. Smith. In July, I was had the chance to visit the International Cooperation Bureau of the CCDI. And the director, Mr. Liu Jianchao, he was stressing very much that the anti-corruption, it's not a campaign, that it is an ongoing effort. So, but we see it as a kind of maybe more as a campaign. How do you see it? Is it really something that would be continuing in the future, or just as a, for example, for the duration of the Xi administration or something?
I have one particular question about healthcare system, because it could be also a crucial question in funding the healthcare in the future. Because in some states in Europe, it depends on doctors' consideration whether more expensive and better healthcare would be applied with regard to the special need, and for instance, the better efficiency of the more expensive healthcare for particular patients. Otherwise, you cannot pay for the above standard of healthcare. Of course, it gives a rise to corruption in healthcare systems, and even also to breaching the ethics of the doctors. Do you think if we make it legal to define which care is above standard and for which you can legally pay, is it the right way to eliminate this corruption, even though it will probably increase the social inequality in society?
Okay. Live in Britain. We have a system that works, just about. Right. Shall we? Who else would like to come in? New people. Okay, you have one there, Let's take you, Professor, and then okay. Let's take these two, and then we'll have a roundup. And then if there's some time, we'll have any follow up. Okay.
Okay. I already seem to be with Jonathan about this corruption. And what I'm interested in is if any kind of connection between the corruption and the human nature. If there is some kind of inherent links between these two, then what we should do, apart from this kind of legal systems and anti-corruption measures, is anything we can do for these kind of things?
Okay. Simple question. What do you suggest as an effective measure? Are there any effective measures? We've described in detail all the problems. What I haven't heard is, what do you think would practically work?
Okay, so let's try to tackle those, and we deal with the ones that relate to us and not with others, so we can perhaps leave a few minutes still more for discussion. On the two little points for me, on the point of the definition, it's not perfect, it's a bit crude, but it's about the process. It's not about the individual. So I think what you're implying is that there can be several individuals involved in being corrupt, not just the public official, okay? I think that's what you're implying. But it's just a definition of the kind of, I mean, I think we all three try to discuss this kind of public level of corruption. I mean, it's a huge topic. We've got an hour and a half, we're stretching it to an hour and three quarters. We have to slice it, okay? So we've ruled out the everyday petty, okay? We've ruled out, on the one hand, this the lower level. We've ruled out the fraud and the deviousness and the kind of double dealing. And we're just looking at this public space area of corruption. And that's just to give you a kind of simple way of understanding what we're trying to focus on. But we can talk more afterwards. I hadn't noticed, well, because I'm not a lawyer, I hadn't seen the UN definition is pretty close to mine. So
it's the same.
Okay. I won't say any more because I'll just pick up if there are any loose ends.
Okay. So lobbyists. Yeah. I think in Romania there is a very ineffective control of lobbyists. In Brussels, you have this code which is voluntary, but as a result of being voluntary, I'm not quite sure what benefits as a lobbyist you get by being a subscriber to the role. The difficulty is lobbying can be extremely supportive of the legislative process, because it can bring out things which otherwise might not be understood by those who are taking decisions. If the lobbying is accompanied by brown envelopes or privileges or benefits, then of course it becomes corruption. Equally, if the brown envelope doesn't lead to the result, and there you come into the cultural issue of gifts, there are some countries where if you ill-advisedly say, where can I buy such and such? And they will say, oh, I'll take you there, and it's handed over. What do you do then? Do you say, I can't possibly accept that? You're starting to get into quite complicated things. Does it make any difference? That's a question the public official has to ask him or herself.
Terminology.
There's
a terminology in Romania
for
recognizing something that's bad.
It has changed. After the nightclub fire I referred to, the slogan which you saw on the streets of Bucharest, and there were tens of thousands of people, there were 60,000 people demonstrating after that, was corruption kills. And that is a pretty good slogan. It's a bit like taking back control in the Brexit debate. So I would say that there has been a bit of a change in the way people perceive things. On charities in Romania and Europe, most non-governmental organizations in Europe are regulated by an independent body. Some are better than others. They are mostly short of money themselves, so they don't regulate as well as they should. And there are also elements in terms of what constitutes a charitable object. If you look at how it's regulated in this country, which I'm relatively familiar with, it's still pretty impenetrable, and there is a lot of discretion. And I can say this from experience, having just tried to register a new charity. I came out of that with something, with an object which was acceptable to me, but I couldn't for the life of me understand why.
And the word independence is very important.
Yeah.
It's quite difficult to be independent of the state, but the commissioners are they elected?
No, they're appointed. They're
appointed by an independent board in a public way, okay? And they're usually people of some standing.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's how it creates a sense of independence.
But this is not the case in all countries, and so you have different regulatory structures.
Healthcare.
Yeah, healthcare, yeah. In Europe, certainly, you have very different practices. In quite a lot of countries where you have a system of medical insurance which is state-backed, and you have minimum levels of hospital care, for example, in terms of whether you're at a four-bed ward or a two-bed ward, and you have to pay out of your own pocket unless you have special insurance to get in two beds rather than four or a single room. But typically, in most countries where the health insurance system works, you should get the same treatment. But it doesn't happen in Romania because the system doesn't have enough money. And it's as simple as that. And where you are short of money, you have to have some way of rationing treatment. Whether you do it in an inequitable, arbitrary way, depending upon how much you hand over to the surgeon and the people who are treating you, as continues to be the case in Romania, or whether you do it by having some form of independent body, as you have in this country, which determines what the system can afford, and then you discover the system can't afford it, but that's a problem for the government, then doctors typically will want to get away from any decision which is not based on purely objective, ethical,
medical
reasons. Yeah. But they don't always manage that. Yeah. And in a system that's starved of cash, they tend to move towards
family. So we've got a very interesting story this morning where one health trust is saying that people who are fat, obese, or who smoke are going to have to wait a year for their operation. Because they can't deal, because we have a free system, it's slightly unusual. Okay, so that's an interesting thing to discuss maybe over lunch.
Yeah.
I'm going to move.
Corruption and human nature, what can we do? I mean, I think the answer is you have to reduce the opportunities and rely on people's moral sense.
Exactly. What I've tried to say before, incentives to behave well. There is a booklet going around, which is I was involved in. It has to go around 40 people, so keep it moving. Just to give you an idea of what happens, it's a project that I come originally from Pakistan, I mean, although that when it was India. And this is a little project to provide civic education. And the title is Clean Money for Clean Politics. And it's a kind of thing that you want, so we do it in schools, you know. But these are small blips, which are encouraging your planting seeds.
Yeah, we had a campaign in Romania. Don't give bribes. Nu da spaga. Spaga is the word for a bribe in Romania.
Everything helps. I think you were making in your lecture. Everything can help, but not. It doesn't mean it's transformative. Mm.
Okay, I'm going to answer. I've got seven questions on the list. I'm going to ask them in different groups. So if I answer your question slightly out of order, please just stay with me. I'm going to start with the questions about culture. I'm then going to answer the questions about lobbying and politics, and finally I'll come to the questions about what would work, what do we do about this. So the two questions I wanted to answer on culture are Sipka's original question about terminology and one more question about the Ishan one line. The first question is to what effect does terminology have? I don't think terminology matters in itself so much as the sort of broader ideological attitudes towards corruption. I think in China in particular, everybody knows corruption is wrong, and it's not like it goes by another name. You know, I think the first example I gave you from Celadon, from Qingzi, hopefully illustrates that. I think if anything, corruption is probably considered to be more wrong in China than it is in many European countries, but people still do it. And I think maybe over the break, I'd be interested to know in particular what Paul thinks about this in comparison with an Indian perspective. Because India, to my mind, I know very little about India, I stress, has a less arbitrary system of government by pretty much any measure than China, has a greater formal level of transparency than we have in China. As a free press, and yet I think social attitudes towards corruption are probably more nuanced, let's say, in India than they are in China. There's a greater acceptance, I think, of official corruption from what I have felt. And that in some ways produces a better system, in some ways produces a worse system, and I'd love to know more about that. In particular, one thing that this sort of terminology and this culture does, though, is it forces corruption even further underground. As far as I understand it, if you were a corrupt official in India, a lot of the money that you gained by corrupt enterprise would stay in India. Whereas in China, the reason why they find 3.5 tons of cash in Mr. Wei's basement is because it can't be invested in a town. You know, it can't leak out into the general economy. It either has to go abroad and be hidden abroad, or it has to be literally hidden in bundles of 20s in the basement. The People's Bank of China estimated that since about 1990, 18,000 corrupt officials fled China, and they took $120 billion with them. $120 billion. And that, you know, that's presumably a conservative estimate, given that they found $14.5 billion in Zhou Yongkang's family assets. So I'd be interested to know how our social attitude towards corruption changes the way that people engage in corrupt enterprise, and in particular, changes the way that corrupt money filters back out into the green economy. So, one last question on cultural tradition. I can only scratch the surface of it, and I think it's a fascinating question, but I chose not to answer that exam question just for reasons of space and time. So I'd love to talk more about this, and in particular I'd love to hear about your paper, which unfortunately I couldn't attend this morning because I was looking after my kids. There is a culture of mutual gift giving, and the cultural lattice upon which corruption is painted in China, I think, is much more complex than even that. So one issue I've looked at, for example, is the nature of moral obligation in China and how Chinese people consider their moral obligations to others. So you're probably familiar with the Chinese sociologist Fei Xiaotong, who wrote From the Soil, which is a sort of classic exposition of Chinese traditional sociology written in the 1950s. And it describes a sort of post-Confucian sense of moral obligation that extends in ripples from your person to other people around you. And Fei Xiaotong says it's essentially private in nature. You know, so your sort of official obligations to people that you gather through your official positions often have a less palpable normativity, a less palpable sense of moral obligation than your personal obligations to people who are very close to you. Now, I can't test that. I'm not a Chinese person. Certainly the Chinese people in the room will have their own views on that. But these kinds of ideas about how different sort of cultural, social, moral systems create more fertile or less fertile conditions for corruption are interesting, and as I say, I can't really go into them in detail here. What I would say though is that this isn't, you know, as Paul said in the very first part of the introduction, this isn't a peculiarly Chinese problem. Clientelism, the idea of having patrons and clients, is a European idea that goes back at least to Rome, and probably further than that. And if you measure the number of official cars per capita in European countries compared to China, we do not come out well from that either. So, you know, I cannot give you an exposition of how our respective cultures provide a condition for corruption. But please tell me more about it, and I'd love to talk further about it. So Robert's question on how does lobbying work in China? Well, it doesn't, and I'll come on to that. But compare Britain. So Paul is right to say political parties are the place you should focus on. So if you read the Transparency International Country Report for the United Kingdom, which was published in 2011, there are three basic problems with corruption in Britain, they say. There are lots, but three main ones. Sport, the prison service, and politics. You know, so two relatively important aspects of public life and one absolutely central and important one. So the way that our lobbying works is a problem for us. And if you look at, for example, the recommendations of our Commission for Standards in Public Life, which was set up in the 1990s in response to a number of corruption scandals, They have simple things like political party funding measures that have not been taken up, just cannot be dealt with politically. So China's not unique in that. But the failure of formal institutional structures to channel political lobbying leaves space for corrupt structures. These sort of informal, non-institutional lobbying structures, which are corrupt, could be crowded out if we had better formal structures. And in that, you know, think about how you have to lobby the party. Now, if you're a foreigner and you wish to lobby the party indirectly, you'll go through the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Now, even the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Wang Yi, is probably the 75th most powerful Chinese official. You know, you're not going to get that far going through the, you know, going through your desk department, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Let's say you go at the party directly, you go through the international department of the party's central committee, through its YBAN, its international office. That's still really some way from being able to influence policy in China. So as a foreigner, you have to go through individuals. If you're a Chinese citizen and you wish to take a petition, you go to the Office of Letters and Visits of the State Council, and your local government will try and prevent you from doing that. And your scope for actually any sort of lobbying, I'm not even talking about kind of public affairs or engaging the press, I'm talking about directly lobbying on your own behalf. The scope to lobby on your own behalf independently is very, very limited. If there were better, more independent, formal institutional structures that channel lobbying, there would be less scope to lobby through individuals. So how factional, how political is this? Is this an ongoing campaign, or is it a permanent feature of Chinese political life now? I think when it started in 2012, the consensus opinion amongst betting people was that this would run into the sand in late 2013. People have been waiting for this campaign to stop for a while. I think it's metastasized. It started off, I think, as a sort of classic strike hard campaign where party officials were expected to report on, you know, they sat in denunciation sessions in the afternoon, reported on their superiors and their subordinates, and that information was taken and thought about. Then after it went into Zhou Yongkang's patronage network, we thought Xi Jinping was seizing power of the security apparatus. Then after that, we wonder whether it's Xi sharpening his axe before the 19th Party Congress. You know, he's eliminating political opposition before he does something difficult like reform state-owned enterprises. I think the key point about this is that it's not reform. It doesn't matter whether you call it an ongoing campaign or you call it an impermanent, you know, ephemeral political choice by Wang Qishan. The fact is they're not changing anything. And a strike hard campaign, sort of a yen da campaign, is essentially where the government just runs the same machine but runs it faster and harder. It doesn't change the machine, doesn't reform the machine. And as I've said, I think without formal changes like changing the structure of the civil service, introducing transparency, introducing a greater degree of independence, that's not going to get better. So that's the final question, you know, what would work? I can give you a short answer. I'll first answer the question of law and rules, which I think speaks to the same issue. It doesn't matter in China. A law is just a particularly permanent sort of policy. You know, and Tiaoli or other kinds of regulations have a similar normative status to law in certain places. So I don't think there's an important difference between doing it through law or doing it through regulation. They both have the same similar institutional effects. But two things, independence and transparency. You know, we've not seen many big countries pull out of a deep dive in corruption. But small countries like Singapore, like Hong Kong, have succeeded in reforming their institutions, and they did it through those techniques. They created functional independence within government, they created transparency, and they made it very, very clear that they weren't going to tolerate this, even people they were close to. You know, that Lee Kuan Yew sacked as defense minister in the 60s because he wants to make a point. China's doing the third of those. You know, it's making it clear that this is intolerable, but it hasn't done the first and the second. I don't think it's likely to quickly.
The beauty of transparency is that it's relatively free. I mean, it, you know, there's a startup cost, but once you set up the startup cost, it's up. You know, each person is required to be transparent, or to file things, or to expose things, and that's why I'm excited about transparency as a solution, because you always get the doom monger who say, well, it's not possible, we can't pay for it. Okay, we've got to stop because lunch is ready. But is there anyone burning to make a final comment or whatever? We may not answer it, but does anyone else want to say anything? I think it's been a really good session, and we've tried to get, you know, try to get down. Both sharing information, but to give you a kind of, you know, picture of it. So you, I hope you, you know, if you were already expert, you're a bit more expert, and if you weren't, you know more.